Welcome to EPG Patashala. I am Professor S.L. Sangam, Professor UGC Emeritus, Department of Library and Information Science, Karnataka University, Dharwad. Friends, let us see model number 7, bibliometrics in assessing productivity and impact of research. Librarians and information scientists have adopted a number of quantitative methods to evaluate library resources, services, and scientific communication. Bibliometrics is one of the techniques used by information managers to measure the communicated records. We have to measure to maintain quality and standard scientific productivity of scientists. Bibliometric criteria for evaluating research productivity. The extent and type of publication of the research results is the most obvious and immediate impact of a particular research activity. Presumably, the more widely disseminated the results of some project, the greater the impact that project or product is likely to have, but publications themselves have different levels of impact. Some formats are more widely distributed than others. Some enjoy a greater reputation, some reach out to wider communities and thus may have more profound effects. Bibliometric criteria for evaluating research productivity include, number 1, how many publications are produced? 2, how many publications of what type are produced? 3, the quality of the resources in which publications appear? How much the work of individual group or organization is cited? What is the quality of the citation? How many publications are produced per individual, per man hour extended, and how many citations are received per individual, per man hour? See, for specifically, measuring is essential to show the image of the individual scientist, image of the individual institution, image of a particular country, or even his expertness in the field of a particular subject. There are several bibliometric criteria for evaluating research productivity, and these methods have many possible applications in managing research. So, let us learn about these techniques. There are several tools and techniques to evaluate the research of a scientific productivity. And these methods have many possible applications for specifically image building of a scientist. And these are very much useful from the point of view of a particular institution, individual, country, subject, etc. So, let us learn these in detail. So far, you have seen criteria for evaluating the scientific productivity. Now, let us see impact of citation analysis. The primary functions of a citation is to provide a connection between documents, one which cites and the other which is cited. Citation is the best available indicator of the use of document. The first use of separate citations published in 1873. This technique of citation has been perfected by Eugene Garfield and others since the early 1960s. It is a fact that compilation of bibliographies in new fields is really difficult. In such circumstances, analysis of citations of articles may be one of the ways to gather information on a particular subject field. The very fact that the citations have been verified, evaluated, and recommended by authors who are experts in their own fields make them all the more acceptable for inclusion in bibliography.
So, just I want to be brief here. What exactly citation you mean? Citation differs references and bibliography. Citation is actually what actually you have taken a portion of a document from the other text, and whereas reference is what exactly you have seen to write a particular article or a book, but you will not be citing it as it is in the article. But whereas bibliography is a list of books. So, in that way the citation is exactly, it is a part or portion of the maybe a sentence, a paragraph or a page which has been completely taken as it is from the text and which have been used in his own article by the author. We have to analyze the citations to know that what exactly a particular author required to write a research article. How much books, how many journals articles, or different types of the documents is going to use to write a standard research articles, so that it will be beneficial or useful from the future scientists or researchers to know something about their own field what previously studied. For that citation analysis is most useful. Just now we studied impact of citation analysis, and now let us study the individual productivity and impact, and how actually the citation analysis is useful from the point of view of the research, and how actually we can determine the research output better if you are going to use the citation analysis as a tool. So much scientific productivity of inflow is there in the universe of knowledge. So, we have to assess of this scientific materials. For that there are several scoring methods are available. Let us see all these things. Friends, when you see the abundant of literature, it is very difficult to measure and assess which one is better. For that there are several scoring methods are there. We can apply those things and we can find out which is better for our scientists. However, purely quantitative measures are inadequate indicators of research output. The type of publication and the reputation of the publisher should also be taken into account. Various attempts have been made to assign some type of numerical score to the output of a researcher based on what is published and where, and this is how the individual productivity and impact is measured. Narin deals with this topic, and more recent scoring method have been presented by him. In general, such scoring methods take into account some or all of the following factors: the type of publication, the size of the publication, the reputation of the publisher, and the amount of work going into creating publication of various types.
Table 1 indicates the average H index of these 20 authors during 1999 to 2008 was 5.85. Only 4 authors have scored the H index value more than the average value of all authors. These authors are Niranjana Murthy with H index value of 41, followed by Amina Bhavi, 28, Sopi Math, 7, and Kulkarni, 6. Table 1 indicates the average H index of these 20 authors during 1999 to 2008 was 5.85. Only 4 authors have scored the H index value more than the average value of all authors. These authors are Niranjana Murthy with H index value of 41, followed by Amina Bhavi, 28, Sopi Math, 7, and Kulkarni, 6.
Looking into the these journal article studies, we have to see there are several measures to assess these scientific productivity of the journals. For example, impact factor of the journal and how the journal is received by the scientist, how the scientist normally citing or publishing their highly impact factor journals. So, let us see how actually the impact of research and ranking of the journals we can make. Journals are an important vehicle for scholarly communication. Garg and Rao observed that impact factors are widely used to rank and evaluate journals. They are also often used inappropriately as surrogates in evaluation exercises. The impact factor for ranking journals was first used for the inclusion of journals in Science Citation Index, and the originator of SCI warns against the indiscriminate use of these data. Lancaster has given some possible criteria for the evaluation of scholarly journals as below. Size includes number of papers, number of pages, and number of words. Circulation is normally circulation of the journals. And use of the journals, I mean how much this population are making use of this particular journal. Impact in the sense citation per paper, immediacy and influence of that particular journal on the cited literature. Age of sources cited means how old that particular article has been cited. And exclusiveness means exclusively how the citation or article or journal has been covered. Coverage in database in the sense may be in abstracting and indexing services journal. The impact factor is generally calculated on the basis of a 3-year period. For example, the 2007 impact factor for a journal would be calculated as follows. A is equal to number of items, articles published in 2005 and 2006 were cited in tracked journals during 2007. B, number of articles published in 2005 and 2006. Impact factor of this we can calculate it like this, A divided by B. So, that outcome is the impact factor of a journal.
There are some citations to this. Institute of Scientific Information, that is ISI, Thomson Reuters excludes certain article types such as news items, correspondence and errata from the denominator. New journals which are indexed from their first published issue will receive an impact factor after the completion of 2 years indexing. In this case, the citation to the year prior to volume 1 and the number of articles published in the year prior to volume 1 are known as zero values. Journals that are indexed starting with a volume other than the first volume will not have an impact factor published until 3 complete data years are known. Annuals and other irregular publications will sometimes publish no item in the particular year, affecting the count. The impact factor relates to a specific time period. It is possible to calculate it for any desired period, and the journal citation report, that is JCR, also includes a 5-year impact factor. It is regarded by many editors and editorial management committees as a measure of importance of particular journals, and to some extent this is true. Journalists such as Nature, Science and New England Journal of Medicine have a high impact factor. The impact factor, often abbreviated as IF, it is a measure of reflecting the average number of citation to articles published in science and social science journals. For example, the same journal, that is New England Journal of Medicine, published 366 citable articles in 2003 and 378 citable articles in 2002. Citations in 2004 to any article published in 2003 and 2002 are 14,147 and 14,549 respectively. Following formula used to calculate the IF for these journals in 2004. IF is equal to 14,147 plus 14,549 divided by 366 plus 378 is equal to 38.6 in 2004.
So far we have seen the assessment of the individual scientist. Now let us move to the institutional productivity and its impact. The research output of an institution or of a single group or a team within an institution can be considered as a sum of the output of the individual members. So, the various factors discussed in relation to individual productivity and impact are also relevant to institutional productivity and impact. Nevertheless, the evaluation of an institution does present additional problems that merit special consideration. Garg and Rao, in evaluating an Indian physics laboratory, recognized 4 categories of journals. Indian journals covered by the Science Citation Index, non-Indian journals covered by the Science Citation Index, Indian journals not covered by the Science Citation Index, and non-Indian journals not covered by Science Citation Index. The implication is that on the average, a SCI covered journal is likely to be better on the average than Indians ones. At the very least, one can assume that the international journals will give the Indian researcher greater exposure than the national journals, especially those international journals covered by Science Citation Index.
Again taken from the study of faculty of Karnataka University, who had published their total research output in 238 Indian and foreign journals during 1999 and 2008. The contribution of top 20 most productive journals is listed in Table 2. The cumulative output of these top 20 journals consists of 179 papers during 1999 to 2003, 301 papers during 2004 to 2008, and 480 papers during 1999 to 2008, accounting for 38.66%, 39.81% and 39.38% of the total output of Karnataka University. Table 2 indicates the faculty of Karnataka University who had published their total research output in 238 Indian and foreign journals during 1999 to 2008. The contribution of top 20 most productive journals is listed.
In the previous sections, we have used the bibliometrics as a tool for analysis of individual productivity and also the institutions of a particular country. And in this section, we can study the country-wise analysis of impact of the research, how it will be useful from the point of use of the scientist and as well as a particular country. Lancaster has stated that when countries are ranked by productivity of scientific papers, most advanced countries will be at the top of the list. However, India ranks as the most productive among the developing countries. Narin has described a cross-country citation measure that compares the actual citations received by papers from a particular country to the expected number of citations. The expected number of citations is based on the proportion of the world's papers that are contributed by the country. They illustrate this in the probabilistic manner. If a country having X publishes 2% of the world's science papers, it should receive 2% of the world's science citations. If it receives more, it is cited more than expected. This can be illustrated by looking at the relationship between two countries. For simplicity, let us assume two countries A and B. Country A publishes 90 papers in a year and country B publishes 10 papers. Since A publishes 90% of the world's papers, in this simple model, it should receive 90% of its own citations and 90% of the citations from B. That is, in probabilistic sense, the equation should equal to 1. Let us examine this by computing the data for A and B.
Number of references from B to A divided by number of references from B. Number of A publications, that is 90, divided by total number of publications, that is 100. This would be true if the paper published by B contained 150 bibliographic references, 135 of which were to A's paper. 135 divided by 150 divided by 90 divided by 100 is equal to 0.9 divided by 0.9 is equal to 1. Suppose on the other hand that 140 of B's reference are to A's paper. 140 divided by 150 divided by 90 divided by 100 is equal to 0.93 divided by 0.9 is equal to 1.03. Table 3.
Friends, as you know that every subject is having its own laws. That is why this bibliometry is also having its own empirical laws. Number one, Bradford's law of scattering, Zipf's law and Lotka's law. These three are the main important and basic laws of bibliometrics. Let us see how these laws are make an impact on the scientific productivity and how best we can make use of these three laws and we can measure the scientific productivity of the scientists. We can also cover H index in this section, how it will be useful to measure the individual scientific productivity. As it is well known, the three fundamental laws of bibliometrics are its foundation. In simple terms, they are Bradford's law of scattering, Zipf's law of frequency of word occurrence and the Lotka's law of scientific productivity. The Bradford's distribution often can be fruitfully used to estimate the total size of a bibliography and periodicals that should necessarily be included in the list of items to be covered in a library and information center, and more precisely ranking of periodicals and suggesting core periodicals a library should subscribe. In the beginning and at a stage when bibliometric studies very popular, every paper would use Bradford's law for ranking periodicals and was one of the common denominator of study in most of the papers. Gibbs' law can be effectively used in the generation of semi-automatic indexes useful for information retrieval system. Its use has increased tremendously with the emergence of natural language indexing of textual matter, especially in electronic form. Gibbs' law provides a measure of the richness in vocabulary of an author. This technique can be used for deciding the correct authorship of disputed works. For example, if there is differences of opinion as to the correct author of a work, the word predilections of the attributed authors can be analyzed either manually or using a computer. Once the frequencies of occurrence of favorite words are decided, the disputed text can be analyzed to see similarity and thereby decide the author conclusively. The law is used for identifying words are more frequently used in the different foreign languages. These words are taught first in the instructional programs of foreign languages. Third one, Lotka's law. Lotka's proposition led to a whole gamut of studies on scientific productivity. Such productivity studies have gained momentum in the post-Second World War period. Scientific productivity studies have been seen made from different angles. The impact of social change on scientific productivity, relationship of publication output on scientific recognition, identification of elites in different disciplines, occurs of discoveries in different cultures. H index is now popularly known as Hersha index. Actually, it is by a scientist, by the physicist. His name is Dr. Hersh. It is his contribution. With the help of the H index, we can measure the individual productivity of an author. How many articles he has published in the scientific periodicals? How many of them have been cited? That we have to assess. The main criteria for here to assess the H index, first, for example, if a scientist published 30 papers, all of his papers cited 30 times, then his H index will be 30. If he is only first 10 articles cited 10 times, his H index will be 10. So, it is like this. If the H index greater the H index, the standard of the published scientific productivity is having more quality in its nature. For example, I can give the best example, our national scientist Rao. One of his articles cited 240 times and his H index more than 70. So, with help of this, you can judge or evaluate the productivity of a scientist. Friends, so far you have seen how actually the bibliometrics is useful from the point of view of the evaluation of the scientific productivity by individual author, by institutions, by country, and by even individual journals, and with the help of the Bradford's law, Lotka's law, Zipf's law, also with the help of the H index. Now, this is the time we can see how does we can measure the decay of the literature. Decay in the sense absolute. Absolute in the sense nobody are making use of this particular journal or article or document. That we can see with the help of the available literature. We can measure same thing like this. Citations in subsequent literature and usage pattern in libraries are considered as two indicators of the obsolescence of literature. Analysis of citation by age of the cited document can show how the useful life of a document. In order to measure the decay or obsolescence rate of documents, the concept of half-life has been borrowed from nuclear physics. Using this measure, Burton and Kabler had suggested a range of half-lives for different subjects. The fast growing subject would have lesser half-lives compared to established disciplines. The above study had shown the half-life of metallurgical engineering 3.9 years, while that of botany is 10 years. These time scales are highly useful in the planning of library holdings. Friends, in this model, we have studied the bibliometric analysis, how we can use it for analyzing scientific productivity of individual authors, individual country, individual institution, individual journal and its ranking, and further with the help of the bibliometric laws, Bradford's law, Lotka's law, Zipf's laws. So, how these three laws can be used measuring these productivity. And also you have studied how H index is useful for measuring the scientific productivity of individual scientist. And you have to remember that higher the H index, higher the standard of a scientist. So, with these things I can conclude here. If you want more, you can go to text. Thank you.